off, let's say, in 2 years, and they're going to want signs, and then it's going to fit right into Ellen's criteria now, you know, who had the right paperwork done. Now, if we're coming ahead on budget, we might be able to squeeze it in this year.
What was the $20,000 budget?
It talks about the planning.
Just changing our policy.
Yeah, rewriting the whole code. Getting up to date, comparing it to other codes. I don't know to, you know.
You did the whole personnel policy.
Yeah, but this, that was, we borrowed that from some people, and maybe we could borrow it from Baycock, I really don't know, but Ken Garrett, in his firm, they give this information, they don't give it out, but that's what they do, that's their business.
Analyze existing sign ordinance, compare other ordinances, hold initial meetings and conduct field visits to assess the existing signage stock in the village. This will include photos, drawings. It's a time-consuming process also. Yeah, I mean, no matter who we go with, however we handle it, this could be a 6 to 9 month project from what I'm being told. So again, it's not something really quick.
I have a question. I heard that the zoning board offered to do something like this. The zoning board offered to do something this change.
The zoning board of appeals has nothing to do, and so they've approached me on several occasions to look at codes and things. I have my concerns because that's not what they do for a profession. They're not experts in this, and so it's really a bunch of very good residents that want to donate their time, and I appreciate that, but whatever they recommend then still has to go through a company as a BNF or a Tesco or somebody to put it into the proper form. It still needs to be then looked at legally and voted on. I haven't totally shot it down, but you know, we really have to look at what we're doing and what level of expertise we need.
But
he did, but Randy's an architect, and he offered to do things, but you have legal issues involved with this. What I'm trying to say is that Randy wanted to get the committee going and educate the members of the committee, which was a noble idea, but technically, like Alan's saying, his expertise is not science, you know, and it's something like BNF is better than that. Secondly is, then you go with the village ordinances and attorneys got to be involved. It's got to be like each separate element doing their specialty work.
Right.
Not just the zoning committee going overriding the village inspectors, you know what I mean?
And you know, honestly, one concern I have, and it's because I am also a village resident, there's a lot of emotion. And I've experienced it at hearings already. And if somebody personally doesn't like the way something is written and they want it written a certain way, I don't think they're going to be objective. And so I have my concerns having residents. I mean, their input's important. I'm not trying to discount that. But when I sit at ZBA meetings and people pounding their fist on the desk because they didn't like this, yet they want to get involved in rewriting the code, I'm looking for subjective, neutral, professional panel to do this, do it correctly, so that it can be in place for 10 years.
Yeah.
And that's just my personal opinion. I'm trying to figure out how to use people that want to volunteer their time, but what's best for the village. It's a tough juggling act.
To be realistic, if we had this lower level done, this would not be a discussion item. I think we have the money to do the lower level. It's just much more we would take it, because I think that has to be done. I mean, we just can't have our employees in substandard facilities. Secondly is, you do a side ordinance, and then this building floods and falls apart, what do you got then? You know, you've got a big investment in this building.
Well, maybe we can make some progress if we can
problems are, but they will, once being employed, they are not saying the village is a problem. However, the planning commission, and the planning commission, their discussions, they're fighting themselves because of the ordinances we have. It's so inconsistent, the planning commission has to go through, and if they weren't regulating things, you know what I mean?
Hey, Jim Connors, can you clarify any typical protocol in municipalities that you've experienced? I've been told before that maybe, you know, we can lean on the planning commission. I don't know if you have any thoughts on if we're going to start looking at rewriting, looking at some of the different codes. Should we be following the way I'm thinking and using an organization that this is what they do? Or should we be using kind residents that would bring recommendations? And we're still gonna have to take it to another level. What have you typically seen down in your years?
Well, either you have in-house staff that deal with this every day, they look at sign permits, you know, every day and deal with that. Because you're not only dealing with the size of sign, but the construction and how it's placed. And then it goes to an advisory body, like a planning commission that reviews the recommendations for amendment. I think in Deer Park, you also have a situation where a lot of our commercial development is not regulated by the sign ordinance, but by the individual planning and developers, which is an agreement with that developer and the village that that's their, you know, special use planning and development.
So each,
it doesn't necessarily supersedes it, it's its own rules, and where it's not, something's not addressed, the general sign ordinance addresses it. I think what being up is encountering is there's gaps in between, or and if it's not clear there's any discretion, then everything has to go to BRB or hearing, and I don't think you want that either. Kind of support.
Well, I think the DDR property is all governed by the original annexation agreement that incorporates the special use ordinance, and that incorporates sign standards. And so any deviation from those sign standards has to go to the Building Review Board. And that's the process for resolving those issues, just like if it was an issue relative to a sign ordinance per se, it would go to a zoning board of appeals and then to the village board for a decision. So, you know, I think that's the interesting part of your sign situation is all of the commercial property in the village is in the plan of development in the PD district.
The promenade, the Deer Park Town Center.
Right.
Yeah, I think the issue with BNF is the general site code isn't up to date, doesn't cover everything, there's some gaps, and so what do you do?
Okay. But for one thing, well, the Building Review Board and the Planning Commission both concur with Alan. That's the way to do it. Would you agree with that, Jim?
Yeah, either an in-house staff or some firm that reviews
it. So they all
there's
agree.
A good number of firms that do sign review.
They do agree with Alan's determination. That's the way to do it. That's the part I was trying to bring out. That I've given this board or the previous boards by doing nothing. Where's the biggest problem in the sign rules? So if you
I'm not sure what we're going to gain by trying to have somebody else interject in part of the process. And at the end of the day, we're still going to need to have a professional firm put it all together for us and tighten it up. So again, I'm trying to be open-minded, but I'm also trying to be realistic.
Well, is there some component of that that the commission's been helping
with? No, I don't. Let me ask you this. We got 1.5 million, right? How much will we get? This is not a fair question to Jim.
You're talking Jim Denny.
Yes.
Okay.
We got 1.5 million. Are we through paying for all the roads?
No, I think we
So it's $200.
With reserves.
So it's $300,000, we're down to $1.2. Can we fund this right now?
Well, I'd like to study that a little closer.
Why don't we table it the next meeting?
Well, this was just an FYI, guys. I put it in the packet. You know, we can definitely have further discussions on this. I wasn't looking to have any motion or put any money aside. I'm just saying that this is something that we're gonna have to start working on. There will need to be put money aside. I don't know if it's gonna be $5,000 or $20,000, but we're gonna need that money aside. And there needs to be a level of professionalism of how this is gonna be written and handled. And,
Alan, I'm sure you, try to give me a better handle on how much money to be putting aside.
And I don't know that at this point.
Yeah, I understand.
The quote from, and this wasn't a submitted proposal. This was, and I've heard some other residents calling me saying, what do you mean you're gonna spend $20,000 on this? We probably know who they are. That's not what this is. This was just a current vendor of ours communicating his concern of a very broken piece of documentation. And in his professional opinion, this is what it was gonna take to make it right.
Yeah.
And so it's more of a, and I got more FYIs for you guys. I wanna share some pain. So, that's all this was, thanks. Some updates, really quick. Josie, as of this time right now, we have issued 92 residential building permits. And we've issued 105 commercial building permits. The 105 commercial is up from the 63 we had last year at this time. The office has been pretty taxed with their resources. Business inspections are moving along. New business in Deer Park, Break the Line Parts and Service on Rand Road, Waffle Gourmet we know about Red Robin. Panera is expanding, as President Kellerman stated, they're gonna have an open house on Saturday, opening up their expansion. We have Brooks Brothers, Honeywell, Heidelberg, USA. Honeywell is moving on to Field Parkway, and Heidelberg, USA, they make printing presses for people, Field Parkway. So we also have Plexus Group, Field Parkway, and Advanced Medical Anesthetics is opening in the Deer Park Town Center. So as we know, there's been a lot of movement and a lot of activity. I wanted to make you guys aware of some zoning issues, and again, just to get an idea of what's recently been going on, what's still going on. I have some pictures that I'm handing out to you, and the first page of pictures is actually pictures I took this morning, and the pictures of the promenade, and there's complaints, and again, there's only so much the village can do, but we spend a lot of time on this. The tenants of the promenade are very unhappy with their management group, and to start off with, they brought up to our attention the dumpsters at the promenade. And these were taken this morning at about 8:30, and it shows the dumpsters outside of the gated areas. The gated areas are broken and pretty poor looking, which then has garbage blowing through the parking lot. And the gentleman at the UPS store is really tired of picking up garbage, but he's been very patient. We don't get a lot of cooperation from the ownership management company of the promenade, and their name escapes me at the moment, but
Gradient.
And so the tenants are reaching out to the village saying, what can we do? And in all reality, we can do very little. But we go out there, we take pictures, we make phone calls, and I just want the trustees to know that it's not, you don't get the same level of professionalism that you get from the town center.
So what did you do in a case like this where the dumpsters are exposed? Do we send them a letter? Do we find them?
We will send them a letter. We will then that hasn't been paid, it's been ignored. It would escalate to a letter from attorney, and, you know, if they ever needed to come to the village for something, you know, we have that hanging over their head. But I'm more concerned about the tenants in there that are asking for very reasonable things. They have reasonable concerns. They're paying a good amount of money to be there, and they're not being heard. We don't have an answer for it, but it takes a good amount of time. So I just took these pictures. I want to give you guys an FYI. Josie, I can give you these. I did note on the bottom that I took these pictures if they ever needed to be used for any reason.
The inspections was done today on the property, and the inspector also the pictures and the inspection report, which will be mailed out to the property owners with the invoice, again, for annual inspection.
The next issue that I just wanted to make you aware of is on Rand Road, and Rand Road and Lake Cook, in that area, there's the Barron's Landscaping that sells the mulch. And it's not Barron's Landscaping, but it's Barron's that sells the mulch. And next door to them is Stephen King Landscaping. And as I've asked questions and got involved in this, I realize I'm dealing with the Hatfields and McCoys. And they, in my opinion, they are right next to each other. They're not best of friends. They have litigation against each other. And at times, it seems like they do things to annoy each other. But recently, Stephen King Landscaping has started packing up skids of salt. And he's storing this salt for Arlington Power across the street. And he's got about now 20 rows of these pallets of salt, and they're 3 skids high. And it's a fortress that he's putting up. And Ken Garrett, Todd Gordon, and I think Jim Connors had to go out to the site Thursday or Friday last week, listen to the complaints, try to talk to Stephen King, look through the zoning code, is there anything that he's doing wrong? I believe Jim Bateman got involved, and a letter has gone out to Stephen King Landscaping, trying to persuade him to take down this wall of salt that is right on Rand Road. I don't know how much it violates, to what degree of violation it is, but the code is a little bit lean, but we feel that there's enough there to challenge him. Understanding that in the next few months, 4 to 5 months, the salt will all be used up, it will be gone. But if anything, I would like to deter him from doing this next year. So the gentleman who owns Barron's next door is calling the office every day. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? What are you going to do? So we're doing the best we can. And again, 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours gets taken up into issues like this. And this is just two of them I'm sharing with you. So again, it's just an FYI. I handed out a visual. We receive complaints on a regular basis. I just wanted to share some more copies with you. Is everybody aware of the Peter Coolin property on Ela and Lake Cook Road, where he bought a strip of land? And it really was the home of Colin Costello, and due to a technicality in the code, I'm not sure exactly how to phrase it, but he was able to buy this strip of land, and he now owns the strip of land next to which the Costellos used to take care of, and he just proceeds to want to do things to challenge them and or annoy them. He's coming into the village office, always looking for permits to build a shed, to build a fence, to put up bushes, and luckily we're always able to not grant him those permits. But we just received 3 formal complaints from Colin Costello about some of the latest. There's pictures on the back of what Mr. McCoolin has been doing lately. He does this in other towns also. And unfortunately, the complaints from Mr. Costello, you know, really there's nothing there that we can challenge Peter McCoolin on. But just monitor the situation. It is a hostile situation. I feel feel terrible for the homeowner and his family, but it's just one of those things that the village has to react to.
I just want to say that I've gotten calls from Peter's attorney warning me of action against me if I ever arrest him.
How are you?
So he hasn't let off his hand.
Let me just say this, Ellen did an excellent presentation tonight, it's all good information. The King versus Barron's. I mean, I got four calls from Barron's in one day. I had to call up the attorney. The attorney told me that what King was doing, the judge told him he could do. I told that to Barron's, and he swore up and down that that's not what the judge said, so I said, okay, have your attorney draw up the paper, give it back to me, I'll give it back to the attorney. That's the last I heard of him, but some of these things happening within the village is driving me crazy, and I appreciate Ellen's patience on this, particularly with this last one. I drive by there, it's kind of like a satire of life, you know what I mean? This poor guy's doing
next.
What's he gonna do next? That's right.
So we're doing what we can to work with the homeowner, and there's very little we can do. I know the homeowner has made comments of what's the village gonna do for me. I've heard comments of if this was a trustee's house, it would be different, but that's not the case. That is not the case. And it's one of those unusual situations where there was a strip of land that legally had no owner. This guy was able to pick it up for a couple thousand dollars. The last I heard, he wanted $30,000 for it now, but then he took it off the market because the homeowner aggravated him and he doesn't want to sell it now. And he wants to now grow vegetables on there and donate them to homeless shelters. So that's what we're dealing with. And again, it takes a lot of office resources, and it takes a ton of patience that I don't have, so thank goodness for the Jim Connors and the Josies of the world, and the Lisas.
Is it, it's Deer Park land, and it's less than acre?
Correct. It's a legal piece of property. That's how it got created. I've dealt with this in DuPage County quite a bit. I call it a non-economic remnant of some other land division that left something that really can't be built upon. The individual applied for a fence permit. We denied it based on a fence is an ancillary use to the principal use, which is a residence. If there's no residence there, there's no need for its ancillary use. But it is a legal piece of property. Separate piece of
can we pass any ordinances that can help control somebody that's harassing neighbors or something that can help
us? I get cross complaints on harassments. Correct. And then their attorneys call me.
But this is a neighbor that's clearly not being neighborly. You know, that's clearly.
He's a neighbor.
Yeah, he's right.
He's a.
The other item that we've got to bring up, and I forgot to bring it up, is, and Alan has addressed it, is 28 Country Lane, the old Waterford Coles properties. People are asking us to do something.
Subdivisions.
The corner subdivision, 28 Country Lane.
We have some Waterford Coles property, and by law, we can't do more than we're doing. I tried to explain that today.
The next thing on, so that was zoning issues. The septic code change, I don't have anything else to report on that. I'm going to be looking to meet with Todd next week. And we're still trying to hook up to go over some fees and what we should, you know, what the Gewalt Hamilton charges us for fees versus what we're charging. Are we losing on it? And I haven't been able to get businesses in Deer Park, 130-some, that the annual business inspection we're gonna be starting, as was last year. And I know there's been some conversation by some of the businesses, as we have the, you know, the fire department comes and inspects us, and then the village comes and inspects us. And they're inspecting for different things, and there is some overlap, but this is what the village, the direction the village decided to go. And, you know, to have, along with the fire department inspections, to have the village inspections. Previous, with a gentleman by the name of Bill Holmes, I'm to the understanding that he did not go inside of businesses, he just checked the signage annually to make sure that the signs were still up to code and that nothing had changed. The village of Lake Zurich does do their annual fire inspections. They check for sprinklers, they check for fire extinguishers, emergency lights. And the village BNF technical who was hired and who's doing their job per the direction of the village is also checking for proper signage, which is a very sensitive subject in the village. They're checking for handicap accessibility, make sure railings are in place, make sure that particular plumbing and all that is working. They're checking to make sure that nothing has been built incorrectly inside the facility. Sometimes with retail, it's less of an issue than it would be, say, with Continental, where they've gone in there and there's remodeling going on the third floor, extensive remodeling, and there was never a permit, there was never anything. They always comply, but luckily, BNF paid the visit and was able to make sure that the plumbing was being handled properly, and the venting and everything was being handled properly. So that's why there's dual inspections, and I guess in some ways there always was with the previous building inspector, except he never just went inside the facilities, the way I understand it. So if the village decides to go in another direction in years to come, that would be up to the President Kellerman and the board. But for the handful of tenants that are complaining about multiple inspections, that's my explanation.
Well, that's a good explanation. It brings up a lot of good points. The items that were disputed were of a slightly different nature. And I think we can probably come to a pretty good kind of agreement on this whole thing. Because certainly we do know that there have been problems in DDR, even with things not being maintained correctly. And we had, at that point, we had retailers complaining that code was not being enforced, and their inspector would have been in the picture. Sounds like there's a lot of those situations still out
there. There still is some issues, guys, with this, let's just say the Saturday events at the mall. I'll just use that as an example. I know we're limited on time, but there are issues when, say, there is that singing event and they're setting up stages. And I don't care how big the stage is, but they're setting up a stage and there's some electricity running. The fire department did come and inspect, and so did Ken, so did BNF. The challenge with that is that's a Saturday inspection, because the thing is being set up on a Saturday and how to handle that. The village might choose that we're not going to inspect it. I don't know what liability we would be up against. We need to look at that. If there was one problem, if an old lady's wheelchair slipped off the curb because it wasn't properly marked, if there was an electrical cord and somebody got shocked, if somebody was sitting on a metal platform and it collapsed, I don't know what liability the village would have. And that's one of the challenges we have to look at. But again, our inspection company, BNF, is doing what they're supposed to do unless we direct them otherwise. And the question is, we don't know. We want to limit our exposure. We want the stores to be successful. We want these events to go on. We want people to come. We just want to make sure that whatever, the 1% chance that the stage collapses during a windstorm, that
full-time people. Secondly, this is not money, but they have an event, it requires an inspection, so they at least pay for the inspection. And if they want to do it on Monday and avoid inspection, and if it's only or do it on Friday and avoid the overtime, they get that as their option. That's their option.
When they're renting it for that long.
Well, regardless, they bring the equipment, they pay additional rental.
If they set up the stage on a Friday night, it could be more liable than some place.
Oh, no, what I'm trying to say is that if I'm having an event, I have an option to have an event during the normal business hours. And all it is the cost of bringing that equipment there and setting it up. Now, what you're saying is, they are saying that the cost of the rental, they don't want to pay, they have their equipment there a day ahead of time.
Jim, I'm saying there might be more liability if they have it there ahead of time.
Why?
Well, because people, like, and people who climb on it and injure them.
That's a security issue.
Well, then they have higher security.
They have security, DDR. What I'm trying to say is, right now, the village is not there to subsidize DDR or anybody else. We're there to have an inspector, and the inspector does his job, and they should pay for it.
Right, I would just like for the 14 items that BFI did for sitting, I'd like to know which of those that the fire department also did.
Well, you can contact them and you can find that out.
But the fight DDR, the problem he has is that the previous inspector didn't do anything. This is an educational shock to a lot of people who are doing something. And that's their job.
And I try to balance when I hear concerns because I'm concerned also, but I also have to look at it now as a village official and say, why are we doing this? And, you know, look at it from the concerned resident standpoint or the, you know, wanting the business to be successful, but also look at it as the village has to be protected and get that balancing act. I don't know where it's going to end up, guys. We might decide not to inspect things on the weekends, and, you know, because whatever, I don't know. We'll look into it. It's not being ignored, and BNF is doing the job that they were contracted for. The next meeting, I'm going to give all the new trustees, you know, packets of the BNF agreement so that they're aware of how the organization works, and that will also clear up any concerns.
Let me just sort of, the one I got involved with, and I was very definitely got involved with, was this current pilot. And the crew that came out there to set that stage up, that was probably $10,000 temporary stage for what it was called. The AT&T people that paid for it contracted them. But this was all professional. And they expected to be inspected. That's why they had the better stuff there, and they expected to pay for the additional stuff. We were having the trouble with the amateurs that never gone through this and do this in a professional way. The 18 American Idol, that stage travels all over Chicago. You know what I'm trying to say?
But the same, you're saying DDR is not professional?
I'm saying is that the retailers they have in there don't do this for a professional. The AT&T has a special crew.
Right, because they do this every year.
Well, they do it all over Chicago. They know that this outfit has a stage that meets the Chicago Code. You know, they bring it out. And we had less discussion than we had with this DDR thing. I mean, they paid the bills right away, and that was not cheap.
That was like an important thing. You know, it was American Idol.
Well, sure,
$30
is that Lake Zurich does things when they want to do them their certain way, and they've been moving forward with fire inspections, and they have not notified Deer Park as we've requested. We've communicated our disappointment, and we've told them that this can't keep up, and we also assist them with some of their paperwork, which we'll talk about next month. And we've communicated that if they don't cooperate with us, we're not going to process their paperwork anymore, and we're getting some cooperation now. But the goal again is to be business friendly, one visit, fire department, Deer Park, annual inspection, wrap it up, and it really hasn't happened this year the way we had asked.
So this annual business inspection, your goal is to have it done the fire departments in conjunction with the building inspectors?
Yes.
How much do they pay for this? I'm curious.
For fire inspection?
No, for the annual business inspection.
They have
in addition to their business license, right?
Can you clarify that, Josie, more specifically than I'm
square footage for fire department and $60 for a business for a building inspector.
How much was it?
$60 building inspector and for square footage fire department. It depends on the square footage. So if I can from $60 to $800.
$60 to $800?
Correct. For, let's say for Continental, it will be maximum $800. For average, from 1,000 to 2,000 square footage, it's $65. And then it goes up from 1,000 to 2,000, 2,000 to 5,000 square feet.
Okay. So the
maximum
is 800.
Yes.
The Deer Park annual fee is a fraction of the fire inspection fee.
So the fire inspector charges them as well?
Correct. And we handle all the paperwork for fire department.
I'm going to pass this down to Trustee Finley. I'll need it back. It's a kind of sample of that's a small invoice.
Is it?
That's unless Rita has any other comments, that's all I have. Thanks.
Thank you, Owen. Very good display, I think. You may want to bring out the King of the Barons in the village, aren't you? Good patriots. With that, Jim, you need your...
Yes, I'll be brief. Just to follow up with Alan, I think the new fire chief is coming over to visit us next Monday or Tuesday to talk about cooperation.
Okay, great. You were very tactful how you handled that.
I think it was less than tactful. I just told him, if you don't want to cooperate with us on doing inspections, then do your own billing.
That's good.
That seemed to work quite effectively.
Yeah, it turned the corner on the situation. The Great Gate thing we've done. On the electric aggregation, as you can see from all the newspaper articles and that, it's an ongoing discussion among communities, especially here. And I learned today that Baycock will be having this as one of their main topics, and the President Buddha of Barrington Hills is going to give a presentation. So we're looking to aggregate the demand, whether it be in this other loose coalition we have, or through Baycock. You know, it's something moving forward, and I think the clerk had information on the deadline for the referendum, which is...
Yes.
quote from one electrician I thought I'd have by now, or another one, and probably will proceed on that. And I think I showed President Kellerman and Trustee Denny personally what it happened. The status of the Barrington Library Dropbox. At the last meeting, I mentioned about having a lockbox where people could drop off and pick up stuff. And what happened was that was the original proposal. I had learned from talking to them that they strictly want to put a Dropbox here like they do in Charlie Brown Park. The cost of the panel would be $400. When I questioned their director about having this, the previous proposal where multiple drawers could be put in for electronic stuff, books, materials, he says that may be coming in the future. So if you still want to have the Dropbox here, and the one from Charlie Brown would be removed, our cost would be $400, and they would have that built into the contract with their contractor.
Funding is whatever, they have a surplus. But they were talking about developments, and they talked about this, about moving the Dropbox.
Oh, okay.
They are, and I thought it said that they were going to pay $400 for the company. But we had a pay for the company. So I'll be good to help you.
Okay, if you could, I'd appreciate that. Other than that, they want to move forward, unless there's any objection. Again, it's not the idea that a previous village board saw. It's been downsized, but they would be relocating it there.
Well, since there's already one at Charlie Brown, why don't we keep it, is it possible to have both?
They said no.
Okay.
I voted yes for the movement of the pad, just because of, I thought it would be more enhanced than the electricity and all this. Personally, Charlie Brown is kind of more in the center of town, it's more conveniently located. I understand the downsides, that it's not lit, and it has some snow. We use the Dropbox a lot for the kids. So coming to the barn is just a longer ride. I guess it still is a better location.
Yeah, I agree with Trustee Zarnick on that. I mean, from a residential standpoint, the Charlie Brown Park is more centrally located.
Well, for anybody, the residents of Huber Road, they would be a better location. And I think it's one of the concerns with the Dropbox being near Charlie Brown is Barrington Library is having trouble turning around, especially with snow. It's a lot of snow.
It's community service, either location, so we've got to turn that around.
And this is more the community center. Yeah,
this would be the community out. In either location, so that's all. Just a voice or where do you want to
run it? I would want it here.
What?
I would want it where it is.
Okay.
I would vote to leave it where it's at.
I would go over here. Okay. Joel?
Here, where it is.
Okay, that's why I would like
Charlie Brown?
Charlie Brown. Okay, just to go back over what we brought up, village office electric service problem. Jim and I took a look at it. It's done. Professionally, it looks like it was done when the building was still. Install electricity because you had to install that at the time you put people through electric service, and I don't think you could do it safely without the electric service being put in at that time. Because that's what they're complaining about, it's a safety hazard. If you had to do it when you put that box up originally, of course, that new office was electrified.
Well, the last thing I have is a meeting with the developers for the Rand Road project Wednesday night to get started.
It's just another defect in the construction of this Behe barn and office situation.
It's all tied in there.
And I just keep wondering, when are we going to get bottom of this? It seems like it turns up